And I asked her to go on a date last night, and she had plans, and she made for all of you, you were important to her, and she made her Christmas fudge that she's done every year. And so please, as you leave, Lisa will be back in the narthex area passing out fudge. The big brick is for families, and then there's some with little bricks in there, and that's for single people. So, but she worked her butt off. I helped do a little bit, not much, but we thank her for it. Okay, I have the wrong one. A lot going on, so the roof will probably, hopefully, be starting in January. There's going to be some big changes, so probably once they start, we'll be doing services for the next few weeks in the fellowship hall. And so just be prepared for that. We have no idea how long. The insurance is estimating. Please call the office and let us know, and we'll be happy to tell you about it. But there will be, we might have to do some new carpet and some other things in here as well. So we'll update you as we go with that. Let's see here. Flowers are on sale for our poinsettias. For the last few years, we've always ordered them ahead of time, and people can sign up and pay for them. And so there'll be people in the back at the welcome, I think today, right, Diane? That will sell, I think they're going for $10, $10 a poinsettia. There's 24 or 28 of them. So please, please, what you'll do is after our Christmas service, service of the bells, Christmas morning, then you'll just pick them up and take them with you, and but it will be a blessing. And so we wanted to remind everyone of that. Women's Ministry Secret Santa Workshop takes place and starts this year on Thursday. That's a real amazing thing. It will be set up for, I believe, where is Claire? Oh, Joyce? Cindy knows too. What they do is they set up Thursday, and then the kids from the preschool get to come and purchase their Christmas gifts, and it's really, really amazing. And then it will be set up for next Sunday, too. Oh, it's not? And we need volunteers for wrappers, but it won't be for Sunday school next week? Oh, we've done that way before, right? Okay, not this year. So Thursday, Friday, or just Thursday? Oh, wow. Okay. I'm misinformed. Okay, well, it's exciting, and they need wrappers. We need a lot of volunteers and a lot of wrappers. So please, if you're willing to come in on Thursday, check out the bulletin for more information. Christmas services, I want to talk about that. Christmas Eve, we have a 6 p.m. and a 9 p.m. Somehow we had a sign-up sheet in the back, and there was only one for 6, so I asked people to fill out on the back for 9, and now that's kind of been, so there now is 2 sheets. So if you did sign last week for 9 o'clock on the back, just please sign again. We're trying to keep track in case we have to add a third service. We don't know how many we're going to have. So all you have to do is write your name, and then put 5 or 6 or 3 or 10 each, right? Can I say if you bring 10 each, that would be, no, I'm just kidding. But that's how we're going to get people here, and that will help us understand if we need to do a third service or not. We had another beloved member of our church pass Friday morning at 7:30, and so we don't have all the details yet, but we will be figuring that out this week. I meet with the daughter on Tuesday, but that is Joan Williams. Joan Williams is a wonderful lady. I remember every time she was at seniors and I would visit, or every time she was here in the sanctuary, she would always say, "You don't know who I am." And I would say, "I know who you are, Joan." And so she was a wonderful lady, and she's had some struggles the last few years, and she hasn't been to church very often because her daughter had her move in with them. And so And then with COVID, she hasn't been here very often in the last 2 years. But she passed in her sleep. She had a flu or a virus that got her in the end. But she was a wonderful, wonderful lady. And so we'll let you know on services for her, services for Doris Ahern, and services for Jean Weaver coming up in the future here. Most of them are going to be in January, so we'll keep you informed and let you know about all those services. And I think that is it. Did I miss? Oh, we tried to surprise everyone, right? We said, with the roof leaking, we're not going to put anything up. Well, this week we decided, just because Amy's team came, we need to have it all set up for them. Then we'll take it down tonight. I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. it's beautiful. We love it. Amy and Bill wanted it, and so we were really disappointed that we weren't, but we just didn't want to damage any of this stuff. All of these decorations are years and years and years old, and so we didn't want to damage any of it. And now that we got the roof dried in and we should be safe, we're good. I'm going to ask the Hinosa daughters to come up so we can start our service. Just one? Oh, boy. Okay. Do you have your speech prepared? No. She is going to light our Advent candle. We add the third candle, the candle of joy, knowing that coming, the coming of the gospel message through Jesus Christ, is the only way we can know true joy and happiness. We also commemorate our joyful acceptance of the presence of God through Christ Jesus. Knowing that God is with us, Emmanuel, is surely a reason for rejoicing, always. The Word Jesus became flesh and made his dwelling among us. God is surely with us through all of our times of difficulty as well as our times of celebration. We light this candle as a symbol of joy of knowing Christ. Thank you. Please rise as you are able.
Mercy, pardon, pardon, sin. Thank you.
Heavenly Father, gracious God, Lord, we come to you in this Advent season. We thank you for the remembrance and the message of your Son coming. We thank you for hope, love, and joy. Lord, we ask your Spirit to be with our loved ones as they travel to and from. Keep them safe. Protect them. We pray anointing for healing in our loved ones' lives and just ask for your Spirit to come. Bring us that joy. In your heavenly name we pray. Thank you.
Please be seated. The first reading is from Isaiah chapter 7. Again, the Lord spoke to Ahaz. Ask the Lord your God for a sign, whether in the deepest depths or in the highest heights. But Ahaz said, I will not ask. I will not put the Lord to the test. Then Isaiah said, Hear now, you house of David. Is it not enough to try the patience of humans? Will you try the patience of my God also? Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel. The second reading is from Acts chapter 3. Now, fellow Israelites, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did your leaders. But this is how God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, saying that his Messiah would suffer. Repent, then, and turn to God, so that your sins may be wiped out, the times of refreshing may come from the Lord, and that he may send the Messiah who has been appointed for you, even Jesus. Heaven must receive him until the time comes for God to restore everything as he promised long ago through his prophets. The third reading, Matthew chapter 1. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us.
You may be seated. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, gracious God, Lord, we thank you for today. We thank you for all you do in our lives every day. Lord, we ask now that your Holy Spirit be upon us to bring us wisdom and knowledge to help us discern this message so that it may transform our hearts, change our minds, and leads us in closer relationship to you. In your name we pray. Amen. I forgot to say something in announcements. I just have to pick on Pat for just a minute. Army beat Navy. Chris is in here, so I would pick on Chris as well, but I did have to say that. I didn't watch it, but I seen the headlines. So double overtime. Okay. It's a month of December, right? It's Advent season. And so I thought this year, every week until Christmas Eve, we're going to talk about the prophecies of the Old Testament and how they've been fulfilled. So one of America's favorite holiday songs this time of year is the classic, I'll Be Home for Christmas. The song was originally written during World War II. To honor soldiers who long to be home for the holidays. So me, as a veteran of many years of the Army and being gone during these difficult times, I understand this song in a bigger way than I did before. But it has been sung by the likes of Bing Crosby, Frank Sinatra, Elvis Presley, Kelly Clarkson, and most recently, I don't know if I'm going to even say this, Pentatonix? Is that the right band? That's a popular band now. And the lyrics of the song make this promise. I'll be home for Christmas. You can plan on me. Please have snow and mistletoes and presents by the tree. Promises so easy to make, but us soldiers know that was hard to fulfill. The words, the world's two most famous promises are promises that are never kept. Do you know what they are? Number one, the check is in the mail. Number two, I'll love you in the morning. Those are called the two promises that are never kept. You know the old saying, right? Promises were meant to be broken. That the reason why Christmas is the most wonderful time of the year is because God keeps his promise. Each Sunday in the month of December, we're going to be looking at these passages from Isaiah, an Old Testament prophet that makes numerous predictions concerning the Messiah. I want you to look at these three great predictions from the prophet Isaiah. In fact, one Bible scholar calls this the great trilogy of the coming Messiah. It simply means these predictions, these three that Isaiah talks about, are all about the Messiah. So what we'll be looking at this morning, Isaiah 7, and what we just heard read, predicts how the Messiah is to be born. Next week, we'll do Isaiah 9, which predicts how the Messiah will bless. And then on Christmas Eve, Isaiah 11, which predicts how the Messiah will rule. So our reading this morning out of Isaiah 7, again the Lord spoke to Ahaz. Ask the Lord your God for a sign, whether in the deepest depths or in the highest heights. But Ahaz said, I will not ask. I will not put the Lord to the test. Then Isaiah said, hear now, you house of David. See, Ahaz is a king that came from the lineage of David. Hear now, you house of David. Is it not enough to try the patience of humans? Will you try the patience of God also? Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will call him Emmanuel. He will be eating curds and honey when he knows enough to reject wrong and choose the right. For before the boy knows enough to reject wrong and choose the right, the land of the two kings you dread will be laid waste. The Lord will bring on you and on your people and on the house of your fathers a time unlike any other. It's amazing. Throughout this series, I want you to listen for these words. Promises made, promises kept. Can you say that with me? Promises made, promises kept. This is hard in our world, right? I have failed to keep promises. And I have made big promises I never should have. And I know what? Another thing. This is a great prediction. Every one of you here has done the same, right? When you hear these words, you can draw an arc from the Old Testament to the New Testament. For the Old Testament is the promise made, and the New Testament is the promise kept. You see, when you hear words of Isaiah the prophet, you get a sense of a detail and an accurate forecasting of the coming one. You see the future. So I want to introduce you to biblical prophecy, or biblical predictions, to some of you this morning. One of the biggest predictions is from the prophet Isaiah, and he predicts this, which we just read. Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. Isaiah is not alone in clearly and explicitly proclaiming the Messiah, the Anointed One. In the book of Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Daniel, Joel, Micah, Zechariah, Malachi, all give predictions about the coming Messiah. It's a different thing, though, to predict the future. I did some digging around, and those whose job it is to look into the future, into the crystal ball, in several fields like sports, economics, politics. And this is what I found. Only two Sport Illustrated experts out of 11 predicted the Dallas Cowboys would make the NFL playoffs this year. So far, they have one of the best records in the NFL. They destroyed my Vikings a few weeks back. In the field of American presidential politics, a few years ago, up to the very day of election, people thought, oh my gosh, how would this guy get elected, Donald Trump? They didn't predict that, and it happened. Economists have failed to accurately predict when interest rates would rise and fall. An economist. Who could have ever predicted in 1940, then an unknown colonel in the United States Army, Dwight Eisenhower, would become president? Or how about this? Ladies, wouldn't you have liked to have been able to predict for sure if he would have asked you to marry him, right? So there was this project called the Good Judgment Project. In an interesting experiment during the 1990s, a professor named Phil Titlock, a University of Pennsylvania professor, gathered two distinct people groups together. He gathered hundreds of experts, and he gathered hundreds of ordinary people. He asked them to try to predict global questions of significance. So in the 1990s, right, the Middle East was going, Iraq was going, it was a big thing, right, 1991, Desert Storm, Korea was kind of going crazy. So he asked some of these things. What will happen to the stock market in the next 1 year? What kind of impact of the Middle East politics would have on oil prices? What will happen in North Korea's politics? These were the questions he asked. This was known as the Good Judgment Project, and this experiment showed the predictions of experts and ordinary people. And you know what they found? Ordinary people made better predictions than the experts. It's kind of amazing, right? Some of these people were intelligence officers and had classified information, and the ordinary people still made better predictions. Predicting the future is tough. It's difficult to do. But there is a book that demonstrates when it's done right, it can be true. The Bible. The Bible predicts that the future regularly, predicts the future regularly and makes a sheer number of predictions. The book of Isaiah alone, this book contains 111 separate predictions that have come true. So it's hard to predict the future. So how does the Bible accomplish this? First, the Bible claims to be the very word of God. 2 Timothy 3:16 says, all scripture is breathed by God. Second, God not only knows the future, but he controls the future. Isaiah 46 says this, remember the former things, those of long ago, I am God, and there is no other. I am God, and there is none like me. I make known the end from the beginning, from ancient times, and what is still to come. I say my purpose will stand, and I will do all that I please. God does not simply know the future in advance. Instead, he knows the future as history. When you're all-knowing, what we do tomorrow, he's already known. It's history to him. Let me show you the first prediction about the Messiah. It goes all the way back to not the prophetic books, but to the very first book of the Bible, Genesis. Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offsprings and hers. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. This is the very first promise in the first prophecy found in the Bible that shows a Savior coming. Chapter 3 of Genesis is all about the fall when sin came into the world. And immediately God says, I love these people so much, I'm sending a Savior. Way back then. The Bible places a lot of significance on the predictions of the Old Testament. Acts 3, which we read this morning, and now, brothers, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. But what God foretold by the mouth of all the prophets, that his Christ would suffer, he thus fulfilled. How were the earliest believers so sure that Jesus was coming, was the coming one? Well, Peter tells us how. The answer is the prediction of the Old Testament all point to Jesus. There are more than 300 predictions laying throughout the Old Testament of this projection of an anointed one coming, the Messiah. It's important to see how these predictions work in today's text. So watch in the moments to come how the king acts badly when confronted with an accurate forecasting of his own future and his nation's future. President James A. Garfield once said that history is the unrolled scroll of prophecy. What is your reaction to God's predictions of future events? What we need to do is live by faith and trust them. Most everyone here has heard of Jesus' virgin birth. The idea of the virgin birth is first recorded in Isaiah. Yet to know the backstory of God's prediction and miracles, you need to know the story of two men, King Ahaz and the prophet Isaiah. Ahaz is the king of the nation of Judah. When this prediction is made and our story happens, it's written somewhere between 735 to 715 BC, before Christ. He was 20 years old when he came into power, and he ruled for 16 years. We find this in 2 Kings. Even though he had a godly grandfather and a godly father, Ahaz was an evil king, and he hesitated when he was confronted with God and with God's agenda. He even sacrificed his son as an offering to an idol to get a victory at battle. Despite all this, Ahaz's biggest claim to fame is that he is listed in Jesus' family tree. The Gospel of Matthew shares, yes, you heard me correct. He is in Jesus' family tree, a guy who worshiped his own son to another god, sacrificed his own son to a different god. And yet, in Matthew, we clearly see that he is in the family tree of Joseph and Mary. Isaiah is one of history's greatest men, a counselor to kings and a contributor to the Bible itself. Isaiah's Old Testament book is quoted more than any other book in the New Testament, except Psalms. In fact, Jesus chooses a passage from Isaiah's writing to preach his first recorded message, sermon. There is a remarkable contrast between these two men standing on the outskirts of ancient Jerusalem. King Ahaz worshiping other gods, and the prophet Isaiah. The predictions of the virgin birth is because the king was self-reliant. Verse 2 describes his emotional state as shaking as a forest shakes with the wind. The year is 732 BC, and an alliance of nations had conspired together and is threatening Ahaz and his tiny nation, Judah. Everyone is panicked, including the king, for he knew his little country was no match for the bullies threatening him. Now, with all this going on, listen afresh to the prophet's encouraging words to the king. Be careful. Be quiet. Do not fear. And do not let your heart be faint. What do you think? Is that encouraging? You're in the midst of a battle of overwhelming odds, and the prophet of God is telling you, be careful, be quiet, don't fear, and do not let your heart be faint. Go ahead and look at the words of the prophet at the end of verse 9. It says, if you are not firm in faith, you will not be firm at all. This is a reminder to us today. When we're going through difficulties and trials, a loved one sick, the death of a child, All of these things are reasons for us to be firm in our faith. Here we see the importance of faith. The king had only a little faith. You know what real faith is, though. Faith knows God is more real than things immediately in front of us. Right? All things are possible. Faith wants God more than the things immediately in front of us. If we are not firm in our faith, then we are not firm at all. If you don't nail down where your confidence is, you will allow the events of life to sweep you off your feet. If you don't have a foundation, you're just a puppet on a string, getting pulled in many directions by whatever comes in and out. Most of our problems happen just like this. Small God, big problems. Instead of a big God, small problems. It's only when God is big that our problems are small. King Ahaz was looking at this, and he asks for a sign. Imagine the possibilities of this for a moment. The king could have asked for the sun to go backwards 10 degrees, or let the moon stop in its tracks. He had an invitation from God Almighty to ask for a sign. Whatever the king needed for confirmation of this victory, whatever he needed to shore up his weak faith, instead the king pretends humility. But Ahaz said, "I will not ask, and I will not put the Lord to a test." God has handed the king a blank check, and he has refused to cash it in. How many times have we done that? When life is hard, divorce is coming, bankruptcy is coming, do we rely on us instead of him? Where is our faith? Imagine the possibility for a moment that the king could have asked for anything. When I struggle, when I'm stressed, I'm a pastor, but do you know what? Sometimes the furthest thing from my mind is prayer. It's how do I fix this? What do I do? Who do I call? Pat, it's leaking again. Get to the church. Instead of saying, whoa, hold on. God help us. Right? This isn't a battle I have to go to, but there's battles all around us. Leaky roofs. Skyrocketing inflation, there's things going on that we're struggling with. Where's our faith? Christmas poses a question. Do you trust in the promise of God, or do you choose the path like King Ahaz of self-reliance? Will you assume the risk of trusting God even in the areas of life that really matter? Remember, faith knows God is more real than the things in front of us. And faith wants God more than the things in front of us. The way the prophets looked at the future was the way we may look at a mountain range. With distant mountains and nearer mountains in the one mountain range. All of them looking like one mountain from up close. The closer you get, you start seeing the different ones. The three-dimensional, not just two-dimensional. Rather than having signs of faith to confirm the king's lack of trust, now he's told despite the immediate consequences of his actions, God will be true to his promise. The child would be male, we're told. He would be given the unique name Emmanuel, which means God with us. He would grow up in humble circumstances, for his diet would consist of curds and honey. And lastly, before he reached full maturity, the two nations will fear will no longer be a threat. Those nations were long gone by the time Jesus came. Be still. Breathe. These are good words from this prophet. Look at the prediction. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord has spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel. promise made, promise kept. Did you know that there is no record birth in Scripture after the birth of Jesus? They kept genealogies and family trees forever and ever and ever. They did sacrifices forever and ever and ever until Jesus' time, and it all stopped. Why? It's because the entire Bible from Genesis to Malachi pointed to the birth and the name of Jesus Christ. Christmas is the question. Do you trust in the promise of God or do you hesitate? Will you assume the risks of trusting God even in the areas of life that really matter? A man visited a church service where the pastor spoke about Mary's conception by the Holy Spirit. He was a skeptic, and he came up to the pastor after the service and said, "I don't believe that story, and I don't believe you believe it either." The man continued, "Suppose a young woman about 6 months pregnant came walking into your office and said, 'I am expecting a baby. This is my boyfriend, and he has never laid a hand on me. I conceived this baby miraculously by the Holy Spirit.' Would you believe her?" This skeptical man thought the pastor would surely say no. To his surprise, the pastor said yes. "I would believe it." Then after a dramatic pause, he said, "Yes, I would believe it if that birth had been foretold by prophets for thousands of years. Yes, I would believe it if an angel visited this boyfriend and said, 'Do not be afraid to take this woman as your wife, for which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit.' Yes, I would believe it if when that baby was born, wise men traveled from afar and brought gifts to worship him, and a star guided them. Yes, I would believe it if her son had power over the wind and the waves, over death and disease. Yes, I would believe it if her son died on the cross, was raised from the dead." Christmas is a question. Do you trust in the promise of God, or do you hesitate? I'm here to tell you, promises were made, and promises were kept. Amen. At this time, we ask the ushers to come forward and receive this morning. If you are sitting next to a pew pad, please fill it out, pass it to your neighbor. And we have special music from Amy's choir in the genre, a mix between bluegrass and rap. I'm just kidding. They're like all the kids, they don't listen to me.
Glory, Hosanna, glory, Hosanna, glory, like chalices. Kings all here below, let steeple bells be swung and e-o-e-o-e-o, by priests and people song.
Please rise as you are able. Heavenly Father, gracious God, Lord, receive our time, our talents, and our treasures to your house, to your kingdom, to your work. Heavenly Father, gracious God, Lord, we just again lift up the promises kept by you. We lift up your love for us, and we just ask that you touch our loved ones, our family, and keep them safe. We thank you for all the blessings. In your heavenly name we pray. Amen. I'm skipping ahead here, aren't I? Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now receive the benediction. May the God who loves you all fill you with his joy, his Spirit, so that you may share God's love to our world. Amen.
Oh, crowns, the king.